welcome to Oblong Books. I'm Susannah Hermans. Before I introduce our amazing guest tonight, I wanted to give you a heads up for the next couple of events we're having at the bookstore. On Thursday, September 19th, we're going to have a Pitchapalooza. This is the second time we're hosting this event. It's basically an American Idol for books. If you have an idea for a book, if there's a book you're working on writing, definitely sign up. You get 1 minute to pitch your book to a panel of experts, and they give you feedback on your pitch. Extremely useful and helpful. And even if you don't want to stand up there yourself, just coming to watch is well worth it. You get a lot of great tips. And the woman who won our Pitchapalooza that we had 2 years ago has her book coming out from Sourcebooks next year. Oh. So I can say that it works. you learn a lot about the book publishing industry and about how to sell yourself as an author. I definitely recommend it. And then on Saturday, September 21st, Paul Hart will be here. Paul won the Pulitzer Prize for fiction a couple of years ago for Tinkers. And his new book, his first book since the Pulitzer, is Anon. And he'll be here reading from that novel. And it's going to be amazing. Definitely come back for that. Tonight we have Susannah Cahalan with us. Susannah has the most amazing story. I read her book over a year ago when it was an advanced reader copy for the hardcover. Incredibly gripping. An up-and-coming 24-year-old journalist all of a sudden one day loses her mind. And she's going to talk to you a little bit about what that means and what she went through. Definitely buy the book. She is a fantastic writer. Her story is both phenomenally interesting, and her writing is completely gripping. It reads like the best thriller. And I'm just so pleased that you were able to join us tonight. So thank you for coming.
Thank you for so much for having me. Thank you. By the way, your picks are amazing. I actually picked up two books of your picks. So I was like, oh, okay, let me try this. Anyway, I don't know. I kind of grapple with how to focus these things because I don't know how much you guys know. So I am kind of operating under the assumption that you guys know a little bit about my story, perhaps. So I'm going to, when I originally wrote this, I wrote this as a medical mystery. So I didn't want to ruin the mystery when I would go. But now I'm kind of going to ruin it for you guys. I'm sorry about that ahead of time.
Yes,
thank you. Hopefully it's still worth reading. But basically, what I'm describing to you was very confusing for me at the time. And it was very much a mystery for me at the time, but I can tell you now, obviously from 4 years later, after the fact, that this appeared as if it was a psychiatric condition, but it was not a psychiatric condition. This was actually an autoimmune disease. So I'm ruining that part for you. Hopefully, the journey is, as you said before, the journey is something that you'd want to take with me. So I'm going to take you on this journey a little bit. So just to set up a little bit, this was 2009. I was 24 years old. I had just started as a full-time reporter at the New York Post. And my life as a reporter, as a news reporter, was kind of in upheaval. You didn't know what story was going to be thrown at you one day versus the next day. So I think it took me longer than it would normally to figure out that something was wrong with me, besides the external of, one day I'm interviewing some criminal and the next day I'm stalking a celebrity. You're in so much flux in that situation, but I think it took me longer to realize something internally was up. So where I'm picking up here were, there were several days of feeling off, not showing up to work, strange behaviors that I didn't quite recognize as being myself, a little bit of numbness on one side of the body. At one point, I went to a doctor named Dr. Bailey, who will show up again in this, who said I was suffering from mono. So at this point, I thought it was mono. That's what I thought it was. But after what I'm going to read, I realized something else was seriously wrong. So I'm just going to go here. The next Tuesday morning at work, my office phone rang. It was Steve, my editor. He seemed to have forgiven me for my recent absence and displays of ineptitude, or at least had decided to give me another shot. I want you to interview John Walsh tomorrow morning when he comes in for a Fox News interview. He's working on a new episode about drug smuggling submarines that I think could be a fun page lead. Sure, I said, trying to muster up the enthusiasm that had once come so naturally. It did sound exciting to interview the host of America's Most Wanted, but I couldn't seem to focus. The first thing I needed to do was a clip search, so I called the Post's librarian, Liz. She is a researcher by day, Wiccan priestess by night. Instead of asking for a search, I requested a tarot reading. So basically, with the Post, what you do is you call on the librarians there, and they do clip searches for you. So if you, so for example, drug smuggling submarines, she would look up every article that's ever been written about drug smuggling submarines, so you have some context for an interview. But I didn't ask for that. I asked for a tarot reading. "Come on by," she said languidly. Liz practiced modern witchcraft using candles, spells, and potions. She had recently been appointed third-degree high priestess, meaning she was able to teach the craft. She wore rows of pentacles and flowing Stevie Nicks-style clothes, and even donned a black cape in winter. She smelled of incense and patchouli and had drooping, trustworthy eyes. There was something attractive about her energy, and despite my innate skepticism, I found myself wanting to believe. "I need your help," I said. "Things are not going well. Will you do a reading?" "Hmm," she said, laying out a deck of tarot cards. "Hmm," she drew out each syllable. "So I see good things, positive stuff. You're going to have some sort of a job change, something freelance outside the post. Financially, I see good things for you." Her foresight wasn't 2020 on this one. Waves of calm coursed through my system as I concentrated on her words. I had needed someone to tell me that I was going to be okay, that these odd setbacks were just blips on the radar of my life. In retrospect, Liz may not have been the right person to go to for this type of reassurance. "Oh man, I feel all floaty," Liz added. "Yeah, me too." And I really did. So from there, I actually went home that night and did not prepare at all, again, for this interview with John Walsh the next day, and came in completely cold. So I was completely unprepared when 9:50 a.m. hit, but I headed out to meet Walsh in an empty office down the hall anyway, hoping I could just wing it. As I walked through the hallway, framed post front pages began to close in on me, their headlines contracting and expanding. "Bill cheated on me. Spaceship explodes midair, all seven die. Diana dead. The kink and I. Chillery." The pages were breathing visibly, inhaling and exhaling all around me. My perspective had narrowed, as if I were looking down the hallway through a viewfinder. The fluorescent lights flickered, and the walls tightened claustrophobically around me. As the walls caved in, the ceiling stretched sky high until I felt as if I were in a cathedral. I put my hand to my chest to quell my racing heart and told myself to breathe. I wasn't frightened. It felt more like the sterile rush of looking down from the window of a 100-foot skyscraper knowing you won't fall. Finally, I reached the office where Walsh was waiting for me. He still had the makeup on from his Fox News interview and had melted a bit under the bright lights of the studio. "Hi, John. My name is Susannah Cahalan. I'm the Post reporter." As soon as I saw him, I started wondering, oddly, if Walsh was thinking right then about his murdered son, Adam, who had been abducted from a department store in 1981 and found decapitated later that year. My mind wandered through this macabre subject matter as I stood smiling blandly at him and his manicured publicist. "Hello," the publicist said, breaking my train of thought. "Oh, hi, yes, my name is Susannah Cahalan. I'm the reporter on the story, you know, on the drug smuggling. Walsh interrupted me here. "Submarines, yes." "He only has 5 minutes, so he should probably get going," the publicist said, a hint of annoyance evident in her tone. So he started going on about these drug smuggling submarines that were made in South America, and I couldn't follow a thing he was saying, so I just basically just wrote down disassociated words to make it seem as if I was paying attention. And at one point he said, "It is very cunning." I laughed uproariously at this line, though I didn't know then and still can't figure out what about that line seems so funny. The publicist shot me a puzzled look before announcing, "I'm sorry, I have to interrupt the interview. John needs to go." "I'll walk you out," I said with pressured enthusiasm, and led them to the elevators. But as I walked, I could barely maintain my balance, bumping into the walls of the hallway, reaching for the door to open it for them, but missing the handle by a solid foot. Thank you. I'm a huge fan. I really wasn't that big of a fan. I gushed as we waited at the elevators. Walsh smiled with kindness, possibly accustomed to this type of eccentric effusiveness that was in fact divorced from my typical interview style. "It was a pleasure," he said. I still don't know, and probably never will, what he thought of that strange Post reporter, because the story never ran. This would be the last interview I conducted for 7 months. I don't remember how I got home after the interview, or how I filled the hours in the wake of yet another professional debacle. But after still another sleepless night, it had now been over a week since I'd slept fully, I headed to the office. It was a gorgeous early March morning. The sun was out and the temperature was a crisp 30 degrees. I had walked through Times Square once a day for 6 months, but today, once I hit the row of billboards at its center, I was accosted by its garish colors. I tried to look away, to shield myself from the shockwaves of pigment, but I couldn't. The bright blue wedge of an Eclipse gum sign emitted electric swirls that made the hair on the back of my neck stand up. I could feel the colors vibrating in my toes. There seemed to be something exquisite about the rush, but the thrill only lasted a moment when to my left, the moving scroll of welcomes you to Times Square caught my attention and made me want to retch in the middle of the street. M&Ms on an animated billboard pirouetted before me, forging a massive migraine in my temples. Helpless in the face of this onslaught, I covered my eyes with mittenless hands, stumbling up 48th Street as if I had gotten off a death-defying roller coaster, until I hit the newsroom, where the light still felt bright, but less aggressive. Angela, coworker of mine, I have to tell you something strange, I whispered, concerned that people might be listening in, thinking I was crazy. I see bright colors. The colors hurt my eyes. What do you mean? She asked, worry evident in her smile. Every day my behavior had grown increasingly erratic, but it wasn't until this morning that my ramblings had begun to frighten her. Times Square, the colors, the billboards, they're so bright, brighter than I've ever seen them before. You must really be hungover, she laughed nervously. I didn't drink. I think I'm losing my mind. If you're really concerned, I think you should go back and see a doctor, she said. There's something wrong with me, I thought then. This is how a crazy person acts. At that point, I began to hysterically cry. And as the crying spell took over my whole body, I became prisoner to it. The more I told myself to stop, the more powerful the sensation became. What was causing these hysterics? I fixated on anything my mind could grasp, picking apart the minutiae of my life. Anything that felt uncertain. I'm bad at my job. Stephen doesn't love me. I'm broke. I'm crazy. I'm stupid. The tears continued down my face, but I was surprised to realize that instantly I was no longer sad. I was fine. Not fine. Happy. No, not happy. Sublime. Better than I have ever felt in my entire life. The tears kept coming, but now I was laughing. A pulse of warmth shot up my spine. I wanted to dance or sing something, anything except sit here and wallow in imaginary misery. I ran to the bathroom to splash some water on my face. As the cold water flowed, the bathroom stalls suddenly looked alien to me. How was it that civilization had gotten so far, but we still defecated in such close proximity to one another? I looked at the stalls, and hearing the flushing of toilets, I could not believe that I had ever used one before. I would find out later, while writing this book, that that's actually the opposite of déjà vu, jamais vu, where everything suddenly seems foreign or strange. After that, I called another one of my friends down to tell them about these feelings that I couldn't explain. And she said something really prescient at the time. It was really something that would stick with me. She said, look, Susannah, this isn't something you can do yourself. You really need to see a doctor. I think you should write down all of your symptoms as if you were going to write up a story about it. Don't leave anything out. As you know, even the smallest details can turn out to be the most important. It was genius. I nearly ran away from her to go upstairs and start writing. When I got to my desk, I wrote only the following. It's my handwriting at the time, insomnia and vision. Then I began doodling, though I don't remember scrawling out the drawing or what prompted it. And I wrote, if you can see, it's a smiley face, and I wrote, people are desperate, they'll do anything. I don't know why I did it. That's there, I don't know what the... Then at that point, I started clearing out my desk, moving away coffee cups, you know, throwing away books and magazines and things I've been keeping as if they were evidence that I was a hoarder who had been unraveling for months. I suddenly felt in control of every part of my life. That buoyant happiness had returned, but even then I recognized it was a perilous happiness. I feared that if I didn't express it and appreciate it, the emotion would blaze and burn away as quickly as it came. When I got back to my desk, I slammed my hands down on top of it. Everything is going to be great, I announced, ignoring Angela's astonishment. I sauntered over to Paul, another one of my editor's desk, high on my brand new, wonderfully simple theory on life. Let's go downstairs for a smoke, I said. As we took the elevator, Paul said to me, you look much better. Thanks, Paul. I feel so much better. I feel like myself again, and I have so much to talk to you about. You know, it's finally dawned on me what's wrong. I need to do more stories, better stories, bigger stories, not the feature bullshit, the real stuff, the hard-hitting investigations. Well, that's great, Paul said, but he looked concerned. Are you okay? You're talking a mile a minute. Now, I talk very fast. I was talking even faster than I normally do. Sorry, I'm just so excited, I said. I'm glad to hear you're excited, you know, because some people have told me that you've been so upset at your desk and you've been so sick the past month. That's over. I've seriously figured it out. Hey, have you talked to your mom recently? Paul asked. Yeah, a few days ago. Why? Just curious. Paul was busy building a mental picture, ready to relate to Angela what he felt were the beginning signs of a breakdown. He had once seen another reporter whom he cared about fall apart. She began wearing bright, inappropriate makeup and acting strange, and she was later diagnosed with schizophrenia. After 10 minutes of my ramblings, Paul headed back inside and called Angela. Someone needs to call her mom or something. This just isn't right. But while Paul was upstairs talking to Angela, I stayed outside. If anyone looked at me then, they would have assumed that I was deep in thought or working out a story in my head, nothing out of the ordinary. But in fact, I was far away. So the pendulum had swung again. I floated above the crowd of News Corp employees. I saw the top of my head, so close that I could almost reach out and touch myself. I saw Liz, the Wiccan librarian, and felt myself re-enter my grounded body. "Liz, Liz," I shouted, "I need to talk to you." She stopped. "Oh, hey, Susannah, how's it going?" There was no time for pleasantries. "Liz, did you ever feel like you're here, but you're not here?" "Sure, all the time," she said. No, like you don't understand. I can see myself from above, like I'm floating above myself looking down," I said, wringing my hands. "That's normal," she said. No, like you're outside of yourself looking in." Sure. "No, like you're in your own world, like you're not in this world." "I know what you're saying," she said. "It's probably just residue from the astral travel you experienced during the reading we did yesterday. I think I may have taken you to another realm. I apologize for that. Just try to relax and embrace it." And that was perhaps the oddest diagnosis I got, but it was one of many. From there, I went home that night, and I had my first seizure. And so I'm going to describe this. Now, this is something that I don't remember at all. So a lot of this book was written based on other people's recollections of what happened, because this disease robs part of basically your ability to make memory. So I had to, as the disease progressed, rely on outside sources to put it together. So I'm going to, this is the first time in the narrative where I really had a complete lack of memory. I couldn't remember anything about the seizure. So I'll describe from Steven's perspective, my boyfriend Steven's perspective. As Steven later described that nightmarish scene, I had woken him up with a strange series of low moans resonating among the sounds from the TV. At first he thought I was grinding my teeth, but when the grinding noises became a high-pitched squeak, like sandpaper rubbed against metal, and then turned into deep, sling-blade-like grunts, he knew something was wrong. He thought maybe I was having trouble sleeping, but when he turned over to face me, I was sitting upright, my eyes wide open, dilated, but unseeing. "Hey, what's wrong?" No response. When he suggested I try to relax, I turned to face him, staring past him like I was possessed. My arms suddenly whipped straight out in front of me like a mummy, as my eyes rolled back and my body stiffened. I was gasping for air. My body continued to stiffen as I inhaled repeatedly with no exhale. Blood and foam began to spurt out of my mouth through clenched teeth. Terrified, Stephen stifled a panicked cry, and for a second he stared frozen at my shaking body. Finally, he jumped into action. Though he'd never seen a seizure before, he knew what to do. He laid me down, moving my head to the side so that I wouldn't choke, and raced for his phone to dial 911. I would never regain any memories of the seizure or the ones to come. This moment, my first serious blackout, marked the line between sanity and insanity. Though I would have moments of lucidity over the coming weeks, I would never again be the same person. This was the start of the dark period of my illness, as I began an existence in a purgatory between the real world and a cloudy, fictitious realm made up of hallucinations and paranoia. From this point on, I would increasingly be forced to rely on outside sources to piece together this lost time, as I said before. So after this moment, my behavior was getting worse and worse, and I finally went back to Dr. Bailey, who initially diagnosed me with mono. So now we had seizures to add to the list. So that was quite frightening for everyone around me. My mom was, you know, hysterical. So in the meantime, while we were waiting to go back to Dr. Bailey over the weekend, I had done some research and I had concluded that I was suffering from bipolar disorder. And I felt actually very relieved. And I looked up all the amazing names of people. It's Jim Carrey, Winston Churchill, Mark Twain, Vivian Leigh, Ludwig Beethoven, Tim Burton. I was like, I'm in this amazing club. It wasn't right either. So, but I went back to him. And so his demeanor this time seemed far less jolly than when I had seen him before. Again, he went through the basic neurological exam and wrote down normal. Right then, I did feel normal. He jotted down notes on his pad as he asked me questions. Only later would I learn that he was missing details, writing down that I was, quote, on a plane when the first seizure occurred, which I was in my bed when the first seizure occurred. His tone was light when discussing the seizure, But then he slid his glasses down his nose and suddenly sounded very serious. Is your job very stressful? He asked. Yes, I guess. Do you feel overwhelmed at times? He asked me. Sure. Tell me honestly, he said, as if preparing himself for me to let him in on a big secret. There are no judgments here. How much alcohol are you drinking a day? I had to think about it. I hadn't had a drop in the past week, but normally it helped me unwind, so I tend to have a sip of something most nights. To be honest, about 2 glasses of wine a night, I said. I usually split a bottle with my boyfriend, though he tends to drink more than I do, I said. He made a note of this in his chart. I didn't understand that doctors often doubled or even tripled such numbers because patients often lie about their vices. I would later find out he wrote down 2 bottles of wine per night. So he called my mom into the room. He actually didn't say this in my presence, but he said, I want to talk to your mother. So he brought her in, and she said, he said to her, I think this is simple, plain and simple. She's partying too hard, not sleeping enough, and working too hard. Make sure she doesn't drink and takes the anti-seizure medications I prescribed, and everything should be fine. It wouldn't be fine. Skipping ahead quite a bit, 3 weeks into my hospital stay. So I kept having seizures, and my behavior got worse. And I was, at this point, actively hallucinating to the point where they actually call it delusions. They were actually very complicated hallucinations. One of the hallucinations that followed me into the hospital was the belief that my father had killed my stepmother. I was adamant. I would kick him out of the room, kicking, screaming, she's fine, she's perfectly fine. But this is something I believed. So I'm skipping way ahead. So at that point, that was the height of the psychosis part of this disease. And then as the disease progresses, there's a stage of it called catatonia. So that's an absence of any emotion or ability to even interact with the world. So this is where I was when another doctor, now this is probably the 10th doctor called on to this case, because I was very much a mystery case at NYU. He's called into the room for the first time. And so I'm going to read a little bit about that. Now in my hospital room, Dr. Suel Najjar crouched down beside me and said, I will do my best to help you. Okay, let's begin. What is your name? And again, this is nothing, I don't remember any of this. This is all blank for me. This is all recounted to me by my doctor and my parents. What is your name? A considerable pause. Susannah. What is the year? Pause. 2009. He wrote down monosyllabic. What is the month? He asked. Pause. April. I struggled here. He wrote down, indifferent, meaning apathetic. What is the date? I looked forward, showing no emotion, saying nothing, not blinking. He wrote down, paucity of eye blinking. I didn't have an answer for him on this one. Who is the president? Pause. I raised my hand rigidly in front of me. He wrote, stiff-bodied on his chart. What? No emotions, nothing. Who is the president? He noted, lack of attention span. Oh, Obama. He wrote, low tone, monotonous, with a substantial lisp. I was not able to control the movements of my tongue. He removed a few tools from his white lab coat. Using a reflex hammer, he tapped on my kneecaps, which did not jerk forward the way that they should. He shined a light into my eyes, noting that my pupils were not properly constricting. Okay, now touch your nose with this hand, he said, touching my right arm. Stiffly and robotically, I raised my arm and in several slow-moving motions, reached my hand to my face, narrowly missing my nose. Hellishly catatonic, he thought. So just some more context in this. At this point, there were 2 diagnoses being kind of considered. One of them was called schizoaffective disorder, which is basically, in short, a combination of bipolar features and schizophrenia features of schizophrenia. And also post-ictal psychosis, which is basically psychosis following seizures. But at that point, I hadn't had any seizures in the hospital, so that was being less and less of a diagnosis. Everything else was coming back clean, MRIs, CAT scans, everything, blood tests, clean. I was normal, but I was getting worse and worse. So at this point, he thought, okay, after he made me walk and I was angling towards my left side, he noticed me sort of kind of leaning towards my left side, which is a sign of ataxia, a lack of coordinated movement. I walked and talked like many of his late-stage Alzheimer's patients who had lost their capacities to speak and appropriately interact with their environments, save for short bursts of uncontrolled abnormal movements. They do not smile, hardly blink, and remain unnaturally rigid with one foot firmly planted in another world. And then he had an idea, the clock test. Although developed in the mid-1950s, the clock test had been entered into the American Psychiatric Association's Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders only in 1987 and is used to diagnose problem areas of the brain in Alzheimer's, stroke, and dementia patients, not typically with 24-year-olds. Dr. Najjar handed me a blank sheet of paper that he had ripped out of his notebook and said, Would you draw a clock for me and fill in the numbers 1 through 12? I looked up at him with confusion. As you remember it, Susannah, it does not have to be perfect. So I hesitated here. He could see me straining to remember what a clock face looked like. I hunched over the paper and began to write. Methodically, I wrote the numbers. Often I would get stuck on a number and draw it several times, which is called perseverative dysgraphia. After a moment, Dr. Najjar looked down on the page and nearly applauded. I had squished all the numbers, 1 through 12, onto the right-hand side of the circle. It was a perfect specimen, with a 12 o'clock landing almost exactly where the 6 o'clock should have been. I have a picture here, if you can see. So it's like a half clock. You can see that. So Dr. Najjar, beaming, grabbed the paper and showed it to my parents, explaining what this meant. They gasped with a combination of terror and hope. This was finally the clue that everyone was searching for. It didn't involve fancy machinery or invasive tests. It required only pen and paper. It had given Dr. Najjar concrete evidence that the right hemisphere of my brain was inflamed. So at that point, he called my parents outside, and he said, he motioned my parents to follow him outside the door. Her brain is on fire, he repeated. He said, they nodded, eyes wide. Her brain is under attack by her own body. So at that point, it gave him enough clues to think, oh, there's inflammation going on in her brain. So he did a brain biopsy, and then he did another spinal tap, and later they were able to confirm that this was actually an autoimmune disease, basically where my immune system was attacking my brain, which was, you know, at that point, I was the 217th person with this specific disease called anti-NMDA receptor autoimmune encephalitis. It's way more common now, but at the time, very early, because it was only named and discovered in 2007. That's when it got a name, 2007. I was treated in 2009. So I got very lucky that this man kind of walked into my life. I get a lot of questions people ask me when I've been around talking about this book, and a lot of them have to do with what happened to Dr. Bailey, the doctor who said I was suffering from alcohol withdrawal. And I wrote a little bit about him initially in the book, about going back to him and trying to get information from him when I was writing the book. And he was very dismissive. He said, you know, I see 30 to 40 patients a day. I don't have time to talk to you. And he basically kind of brushed me off. And I think in a lot of ways thought that I was still crazy. So I wasn't very happy with him at the time, but I'd since written an afterword, which is in the paperback, the new paperback. And I met him again. I didn't meet him again. Our paths crossed again. So I'm going to read this. So I returned to NYU where I had stayed for a month before I was diagnosed. Now this is 3 years after my diagnosis. This was not another book-related exhumation, but to visit a patient of Dr. Najjar's who had recently been diagnosed with the same disease that struck me. When I reached room 1203, just down the floor from where I'd lived for that month, I recognized the patient's parents by the hungry, exhausted look in their eyes. They led me into the room, and I saw her, really me, lying prone in the bed. I saw a storminess in her heavily lidded eyes, but a deadness also that jolted me into the past. This is what I looked like. She gripped the side rails, excited, confused, yearning to touch me, the recovered one. But her body wouldn't comply. It was too rigid and uncertain. But she could move enough to hug me. Her skin radiated heat. I could feel each of her ribs. She looked past me, repeating, "I can't believe you're here," as if to say, "I can't believe you're real." Her parents later explained the circumstances that landed their daughter in Dr. Najjar's care. It was thanks to Dr. Bailey, the same doctor who had believed I was suffering from alcohol withdrawal. They consulted him after she had been admitted to a psychiatric ward. He suggested that they reach out to Dr. Najjar about a disease he had read about in the pages of neurology. He did not admit that he had missed my case, but he had learned from it. So now what used to be called a zebra, in doctor parlance, a very rare disease, is now increasingly recognized and swiftly treated. When I was diagnosed, it was believed that 90% of cases went undiagnosed. Now many doctors know to test for it. It's actually commercially available now in tests. And if it's found early and treated aggressively, about 81% of patients recover well or close to fully. A staggeringly high figure considering how utterly devastating it is at its height. The girl I visited at NYU, for example, is back to work, living on her own, and as vibrant as ever. But despite all the progress since I was diagnosed in 2009, there's still much, a lot more to be done. The mortality rate is still around 7%, even with proper treatment, and some do not recover fully. What triggers the disease remains unknown. New variants are being discovered. As of this writing, I wrote there are 7. As of today, there are 13 different types of autoimmune encephalitises. So anti-NMDA is one type of autoimmune encephalitises, but the antibodies attack very different parts of the brain as well. So it's an emerging field. It's a very exciting field. So I've actually been to a lot of hospitals, and I went to a state psychiatric hospital too to talk about this. I've talked to psychiatrists and neurologists and med students, and it's been really rewarding in that way. And I believe in, but most of all, I believe that this book has lent some people legitimacy to their suffering. For some, I've given a name for what ails them. And for others who still don't have a name, I hope that I've given them hope. Someone once asked, if you could take it all back, this whole experience, but if you could take it all back, would you? At the time, I didn't know. Now I do. I wouldn't take that terrible experience back for anything in the world. Too much light has come out of my darkness. Thank you. Thank you. And I have later, too, if you guys want to know more about autoimmune encephalitis, I'm part of a nonprofit that we... Yeah, so there's more information. But we have questions now, so you can ask me any question you want. And nothing's off limits. I've been asked... everything you can possibly think of, I think. So try to think of something new, actually.
So it was limited to the right hemisphere?
No, it was the whole brain. But for me, for some reason, it targeted the right side of my brain more than the left, they believe. Mm-hmm. Though they didn't do a brain biopsy on the left side. So maybe it was just that part of the brain that's for visual processing that was being affected on the right side more. But it's basically the NMDA receptor, which is located all over the brain. Mm-hmm. And in high concentrations in the hippocampus and the frontal lobes. And the hippocampus is responsible for memory, like a lot of memory formation, and frontal lobes is kind of higher state of personality and, you know, executive planning. So you can kind of, and then the amygdala too is affected, and that's fight or flight. So that's where you get a lot of this kind of paranoia and aggression that you were seeing. But yeah, it's interesting. And mine was a very unique case, because if you asked everyone with this disease to draw a clock, they wouldn't all draw it. Like, they'd probably draw the clock messed up, but they wouldn't draw it on one side like that. That was very unusual.
And how did they treat it?
So it's a, that's a great question. So it's immune therapies. For me, it was steroids, plasmapheresis, and IVIG treatment. Mm-hmm. So basically, it's like taking the antibodies, these bad antibodies, that's basically the force of bad in this disease, yeah, taking them out of the blood and putting new, fresh donor antibodies in. Okay. So that was, and then steroids suppresses the immune system. So they basically just wanted to just rejigger the immune system. And so that's what I did. I was on treatment for about a year. Okay. But for some people, they need to have chemotherapy drugs, more even suppress the immune system even to a greater degree. But I didn't have to do that. Okay.
I have two questions. Can children get this? And then the other question is, since it's autoimmune, can it come back?
Okay, children definitely get this disease. And in fact, in adults, it typically presents like schizophrenia, and with children, it typically presents like autism. So they're different. They present in different ways in terms of your age and your, and plus, you know, a 2-year. I know of a 6-month-old who had this disease. I know of a 2-year-old, and I know them personally, and I've heard of a 2-month-old being diagnosed with it. And you think it's so impossible, because so many of the indicators, well, the seizures are a big indicator, but only 70% of people who have this disease have seizures. But a lot of it's, I don't feel right. And as a child, you can't necessarily verbalize that. I imagine it would just be horrible. But you said, can it come back? So there's, when I originally wrote this book, there was a 25% relapse rate. So it's not a chronic disease, but there's a chance of relapse. Since a bigger study came out with about that actually focused on 600 people, and it's 12%. So it's less. I tell myself that. But I'm 12%, I feel like that's not so bad. And there's a really, basically, if you recovered well the first time, you have a very high chance of recovering well again if it happens again.
Do you have residual effects of this now? It sounds like you're kind of cured unless it comes back, but do you have residual effects that affect you now?
Well, you know, it's interesting because I don't know. I mean, I know that there probably are, but they're subtle. Like, for example, my left side is slow. Remember the left, right, left. Mm-hmm. Left side is slower than my right side, but I'm right-handed. So I don't know. Like before, I never really thought about my left hand versus right hand, which one's faster. But now I think about it. And then also, I'm bad with names, really bad with names, bad with faces. I'll forget words that I shouldn't. I'll forget, you know, I'll tell a story and I'll forget, you know, the name of the... But is that just normal? Is that just who I was before? You know, I didn't necessarily think about it that deeply before. So I think, I bet you it did have an impact on that, but it is subtle. You know, it's not something that I have to really wrestle with. You know, I can do my job as a journalist. I can write, you know, and so whatever, you know, but it's hard. It's hard to say. Yeah, 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 I think so.
First, just a couple comments. When I first saw your book somewhere, I was like, why would I want to read this? It was, you know, it intrigued me. And after I read it, I knew why, in a way. Some self-disclosure here, you know, because of my age in the 70s, I did a lot of LSD in the early years, early part of the 70s, and I didn't have a good time with it all. And I had a lot of, you know, hallucinations and a lot of distortion, and I so identified because what you were describing was my experiences. Mm. That was from autoimmune for you. For me, it was chemically induced. And then when I was in the last week of my 21st birthday, just after the Hong Kong flu shots came out in 1976, I came up with a diagnosis for a condition that was so debilitating, such pain, that usually hits pregnant women who have cats, toxoplasmosis.
Oh, I've heard of it, yeah.
But well, I got it. I don't have cats, and I wasn't pregnant.
Whoa!
And I wasn't even around anymore.
That must have been a rare condition.
It was the greatest headache and the delusion and pain that I've ever had, but it came and it went within a week. And it was just, what I'm trying to say is that I just identify with one thing, is being attacked by your own body. Yeah. And, you know, and just very recently.
Being a victim to it.
Yeah. And just very recently, I had a sepsis infection that came and went within 36 hours. And it's just to be aware and realize that those symptoms, and I know that you expounded as far as like even exorcisms and other types of situations of people that are really maybe not have been insane, but were affected by this.
Definitely. I think you were 21 when you were 21. And I think, I don't know if you feel it that way, but do you think it changed the way you view life? Going through something that makes you aware of your mortality at that age, do you think?
Yeah. Oh, very much. And then I joined the military.
Oh, then even more so. Yes.
Yes. And then my final my real question at the end was, what's the oldest person you've heard of that has gotten this?
Oh, I do want to talk about the drug thing, too, as well. They actually say that the way this disease affects the brain and the receptor that it interacts with is this very similar to the way PCP and ketamine mess with the brain. So you basically can think of a really bad PCP trip extended out for a month is basically what I went through. So, yeah, awful. Would never do that drug ever. I would just don't do that drug. But the other question that you were saying was the oldest that I've encountered was a woman who was 86, and she was actually told she had had delirium because of a urinary tract infection, and she actually passed away. I know her daughter. I also recently, though, on the flip side, met an 83-year-old woman who was properly diagnosed and very quickly and doing very well.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Just to throw something, you know, I don't know if you know, but dementia can be caused and relieved by infections.
And by autoimmune diseases. I actually just wrote an article about this for a BBC Science magazine. Okay. There's something called autoimmune dementia.
Right.
So, you know, and dementia is one of those diseases like schizophrenia where, you know, even a different degree, dementia, you're kind of given that diagnosis and it's a matter of time. There's not much they can do. But with autoimmune dementia, they can actually reverse it. They actually see reverse. I mean, it's amazing what's going on, but even caused by infections as well,
Infection in the lungs, infection in the kidney can cause
makes sense.
Dementia, and then the resolution of the infection and the dementia goes away.
It's amazing. It just shows you there's so much more. You know, all this made me realize how much we have to learn really about the body and not only that, but the way the brain and the body interact because they are one. And there's so many, there's such a, you know, especially in the division between neurology and psychiatry, there really shouldn't be because the brain is the body. They're one. They're one thing. And there is that separation. It's been throughout time that there's been this separation. And I hope that what's moving as science is moving forward, that separation will just dissolve and it will just be one. You know, I think psychiatrists should be able to do lumbar punctures because there are so many, like you just said, there are so many diseases that can look like a psychiatric condition or even a dementia, you know, and they're treatable.
The way you're disorder was diagnosed, there's two things popping into my head. One is the fact that in America, as we're all aware, medical testing is sometimes done for reasons of other than the care of the patient, that is to say the structure of the payment
system. Like we get insurance payments,
And I'm wondering if, in your opinion, that has any applicability to your story. And the other is, was any psychological testing done? And the reason I ask that, somebody might have thought to do one of these paper and pencil things, which is fairly common, and something might have been picked up that something was wrong neurologically.
It's funny, you know, some people say that that's common, but I had many psychological testings and no one did it.
Really?
Yeah, no one, and I know it's interesting because I'm not sure how much it's really used. I mean, I know that there's people are told to at that level to do it, but I mean, in my experiences with so many people I've talked to, when they go to psych first, they're not given those tests. They aren't, and I hope that in some ways this gets the word out to do those tests. I mean, it's so important to get those people to know, you know, to remind them that it's important to rule out first before we make a judgment, because, you know, to be diagnosed with schizoaffective disorder, you know, that was hard to overcome that in a lot of ways. We had to get this other doctor involved because my whole treatment was kind of being derailed, and also being derailed by that one doctor saying I was drinking two bottles of wine a night, because then that labels you as a certain type of person who probably is a drug addict and probably and all of a sudden it's drug induced or it's alcohol induced, or, you know, it's interesting how these labels just, they really can divert treatment. But no, I had many psych evaluations. Like during the course, I saw a psychopharmacologist, I saw a psychiatrist, I saw psychology residents, I saw all sorts of people were in and out of that room.
Do you remember like a traditional psychological assessment?
I mean, I don't think, at that point I was so psychotic, they couldn't sit down and do a traditional psych, you know, they couldn't go, okay, let's go through the whole thing. I was actively, you know, screaming and hallucinating and, you know, so they couldn't sit down and do a 2-hour test with me at that point. That did hurt them because they couldn't do lumbar punctures either at that point because I was so actively psychotic. Yeah.
How fast did your symptoms come on? Like, was it like you were fine one day and the next day things were starting to be obviously ajar?
You know, it was more subtle. I think it kind of, for a lot of people, it comes on very fast. For me, there were small indications. Now, looking back now, I believe are the beginnings. Like, I believed I had bed bugs. And I was so obsessed with this that I began to, I had an exterminator come, and he told me, I don't think you have bed bugs, which, like, most exterminators are going to say, well, get it done. But he said, I don't think you have them. And it's a lot of money, and it's a lot of work, and you have to, you know, clean all your clothes and put everything away. And I insisted on doing it. I did all this stuff, and I threw away a bunch of clips articles and diaries that meant a lot to me, and I just threw them away. So these were kind of behaviors that were strange, but I didn't connect them at all until while writing. Then I went and said, oh, that's kind of a strange behavior. And then, you know, I snooped through my boyfriend's things. Like I went through, I didn't snoop, I ripped through his stuff. I mean, I went through his computer and that really isn't in my personality to do. And so I think, was that in a function of an early stage of the disease where I'm just starting to have these experiences? And so for me, it started a little slowly, though, when all said and done, I mean, this was February, and I was in the hospital by March, so you're talking about a month, really, of onset.
The thing was in February and then March.
So, like, no, the bed bugs were in February. That was the first thing I'd say.
March,
by March 14th, I was in the hospital.
That's pretty fast.
Yeah. Yeah, and then a month later, I got a diagnosis. Oh, that's a good question. Okay, so let me think. This is what happened. So I went back to work about 7 months after my diagnosis, because when I got out of the hospital, I couldn't read or write or really walk very well. So it took a long time to get better. And I actually pushed myself to go back way too fast. But about 2 months after I got back to work, I went to a grand rounds where doctors present their cases. And Dr. Najjar presented my case to this group of people, and a reporter friend had come with me. And she came back and said to my editor, like, she kind of has this interesting thing that happened to her. Like, maybe she should write about it. And so my editor said, well, why don't you write about it for the Post? And it was Tuesday, and it was due Friday. So I did my best to get it done. But after that article ran and the response I got from that, I got a really, I mean, incredible response. I knew that, A, I wanted to figure out more that happened. And so many things, if I look back at that article, I realized so many things are wrong. You know, like, for example, I wrote about having a flight wristband. I actually opened the book with a flight. I remember vividly having a you know, an orange flight wristband that said flight risk in block letters. And this was in my article and in my book till like the final editing stage. And I showed it to one of the nurses who I'm friendly with, who treated me on the floor. And he looked at me and goes, there's no such thing as a flight wristband. And my friends, my family, everyone, flight wristband. They all were adamant that there was a flight wristband. My friend Katie was like, I remember it, you know, I think because I wrote about it in the piece and they destroyed their memories and made a new one kind of deal. Like they false memory really. But they all remember this flight wristband. And I went back to the videotapes. I actually have videotapes of me in the hospital because I was on the epilepsy floor, so they want to monitor your seizures. It wasn't a flight wristband. It was a fall wristband, fall risk, and it was yellow. It wasn't orange. Totally made it up. But anyway, so I've been looking back. I saw how many things I got wrong, and I realized there was so much more I really wanted to understand, and not only understand what had happened to me, but understand the science of the disease, because I had a high school biology background. And then to go into this and kind of understand what, not only what an NMDA receptor is, but understand what a receptor is. Like, you know, but before I didn't know. And so I really wanted to know so I could take ownership over it, you know? So I think it was after that article that I really realized, okay, I want to write something bigger about this.
Has the success of this book sparked an interest in writing future books?
Yes, I think so. You know, I think I always wanted to write a book since I was a little kid. I always loved to write. It's kind of strange to be gifted this topic, but that's kind of how I see it in a way. But I do. I feel like everyone always says this, and I feel like it's so true. And I've never given birth, so I don't know, you know, how bad it is. But I feel like writing a book is like going through labor, and then you forget how bad it is, so you do it again. Other women are like, and I say, you know, I just feel like that's how it was for me. I feel like it was really hard, but I really want to do it again. And I know that I want to do something about science and health and the brain and the immune system. I think is fascinating, but I'm kind of circling the drain with several ideas. I had a few false starts where I thought I was going to do something, but it's hard because to follow up something that's so personal, you know, and that I don't want to write about myself. That's for sure. It's not happening. But no, someone else this time. But and I actually have a really good family story that I can't tell yet because my dad would kill me if I do this to him twice. He hasn't even read my book yet because he can't handle it. But so I couldn't do it to him again. But yeah, I have a few false starts and ideas. So hopefully one day, very soon, I will have another one.
How has this affected what you're doing now as a writer? Are you mostly just focusing in this one area, or are you still branching out and interviewing
John Walsh,
who come off of the TV shows?
Well, you know, that's a great question. I mean, I think it's changed me as a person fundamentally, and then it changed me, and then inevitably will change you as a journalist. So I think I have more of an understanding of what it's like to be a part of a tragedy in a way, like, even though I can't necessarily relate to someone who's gone through something, like, I mean, everyone's tragedies are their own. Everyone's, you know, horrors or grief or, you know, struggle is their own. But I think because I've gone through this, I think in a lot of ways when I'm talking to people who've gone through something terrible, I can relate in a way that as a 24-year-old, nothing really bad, really. I mean, I had melanoma, but that wasn't bad. I mean, it wasn't really a bad, bad thing. But, you know, this going through this, I think, made me more nuanced in the way that I relate to people when I'm writing about them or when I'm doing a story. And I think it made me a better journalist. And I also, now, I actually still work at the Post, and I do book reviews for them. I'm their books editor there. But I also do some science writing as well. So my focus now is very much on science and health. And that wasn't what I had before. I was just a general assignment reporter, and I didn't quite know what I wanted to do. But now I really love that. And I don't think I ever would have figured that out had I not gone through this. I'm kind of mad that I couldn't go back to high school and take science classes more seriously. I'm mad at my little self because I love it. It's great, you know. But I would never have known this if I hadn't gone through this.
You answered part of my next question. But my next question, or two questions, is Steve still your boyfriend?
Yes, he is. Yes, we just moved in August. So we're, with our dog, our baby. But yes. Yeah, everyone always asks me that at some point. I should just, like, wear a sign. I'm still with Steven.
Do they know what causes this autoimmune deficiency?
They don't know the cause of the disease. They know, you know, obviously we know the antibodies are the bad guys, but they don't know what makes the immune system kind of ratchet up this response. They don't know what caused that. There are some theories right now. There's an article that's being published by the guy who discovered the disease, who's very much the expert, and he's looking at the role viruses play in this. So I described kind of having these kind of flu-like symptoms before, tired, you know. So it kind of, and I had a little bit of enlarged lymph nodes in my spine, which could be a sign of a virus, a kind of, so maybe there's a viral response first that kind of makes your immune system want to react. And then once it's in high gear, then all of a sudden it gets confused and starts attacking the brain. But they still don't really know. Yeah. Who knows what the instigator would be in that, you know? So it's really clear. It's really interesting though, because such a high percentage of people who have this are women. Hugely high, I think 80% are women. Not to say that men can't get this and other types of autoimmune disease, which I want to say men can get this too, but very high percentage of women. So you think, what is it about a woman's body that makes it more prone? And autoimmune diseases in general affect women more than men. About 75% of autoimmune diseases affect women. Women are affected by 75% of women, you know, whatever that would be. But so, you know, there's something about the way the women, you know, female immune system is that would make it more prone to dysfunction. You know, maybe it's that it's made to carry a baby. It's more complicated, or you know, who knows? You know, maybe it's hormonal. You know, it's really unknown.
Speaking of, in the last 4 years, how has your health been? Have you had any illnesses or infections or something that actually worried you that maybe something was coming back?
Okay, I did. I'm totally fine. But okay, so I had numbness on my left side, and numbness started everything. It started with numbness, and so I thought, oh my God, you know. And so then I'm typing, and my left hand slower than my right, and then I'm crying, and I'm like, oh my God, I'm emotional. And so I go to see Dr. Najjar, and at this point, it was a couple months before my book came out, and so he's like, my miracle patient, you know. He's like, well, you know, putting me on, and then he does the neuro exam, and his face falls, and he's like, okay, we need to do two MRIs, I'm like, uh oh. And so I get back, it's like $6,000, and I have like carpal tunnel, basically. Yeah, but it just shows you now, because of this in my past, you know. Yeah, I shouldn't even say this on camera, but I'll say it anyway. But I actually, I can't believe this, but I was I went like 4 months without health insurance. 4 months without health insurance. Can you believe me? I mean, I'm an idiot, but I just fell behind because I'm part-time, I'm freelance, and I wasn't living in New York at the time, and they don't have freelancers insurance in New Jersey. So I went 4 months without health insurance. I'm back on, as of actually 2 days ago. I'm back on, so I feel really comfortable saying that now, but it was a little scary there. It was a little scary.
This is why the young people today with Obamacare need to know that they do need.
I completely agree. You don't never know what's going to happen. I should be a poster child for Obamacare. Like, please get, you know, health insurance, because anything can happen to anyone. Yeah, exactly. You could do it. You know, you can have a rare autoimmune disease attack your brain.
I do have a question. Did you go back and talk to the nurses in order to learn about the time you had no memory?
I did, and I had, actually, I didn't, because I had to keep it to length for this, but I originally had a lot longer, and the woman who, I call her the purple lady, because she was dressed in purple, and there were many purple ladies, but there were one in my mind, there one purple lady, and they were the nurse's assistants who would wash me, and they were, loved them so much, and my babysitter growing up was Jamaican, and some of them were Jamaican or Caribbean, and they brought me back there, and they were the ones who really took care of me. And so I went back several times to the floor, and several purple ladies with various names, we now know, but immediately recognized me and jumped up and gave me a huge hugs. And when I visited the girl in the hospital who was on the same floor that I was, a purple lady, gosh, I can't remember her name for now, but she was sitting there, and she immediately recognized me, and she said that they all say, you know, the girl's name's Julie, and they say, oh, it's Julie's not bad as Susannah. She's not bad as Susannah. Susannah was way worse. So they all had remember, and they all had this kind of collective memory of me being terrible, you know, because I was really bad. I was kicking and punching nurses and trying to escape, and I was a bad patient, so they remember me. But they were just so lovely, and they said to me that it was really important for them to see me, because so many times with these kind of acute care places, you don't see people come back. You don't see people recover that way. So for them, it was a test. You know, they were they felt really grateful to be able to see that their work, someone really benefited from their care, and I really benefited from their care. They were really excellent. So I have been, and I am friends now with several nurses on my floor. So, it's been fantastic.
I didn't realize you were combative.
Oh yes.
Did they have to restrain you?
Yes.
And if they did, how did that make you feel? Because there's such a lot of controversy about restraining people.
So my memory is very, very amorphous about this, but I remember vividly, and it opens the book, waking up in what I later learned was a chest posy. So I remember not being really able to move my hands, but moving them well and easy. I think I was let go, and I was able to kind of take my hat off, and I had wires, EEG wires over my head. But I remember being really scared and angry. That's what I felt, scared and angry. And I thought, you know, I didn't know where I was. And then you wake up, you don't know where you are. You're in a dark room. I remember piecing it together like they're taxis. So I'm in New York, and then I can't move. And then I call out, and the nurse actually undid the chest posy. But I remember anger and fear, definitely. But I don't think they had a choice because I was really escaping and violent. I mean, violent, actively violent. I believe that they were undercover reporters, that all the nurses were undercover reporters monitoring me. So I had an elaborate media thing going on. And
it was for your own protection, too, that you were restrained.
And monitoring. They were monitoring me, and I was being videotaped, you know? So a lot of things were real, but my brain was filling in the gaps with something very unreal. I think that is a hard decision, but I think in my case, I need it to be.
What is the business between this, at least many, many people who have this, and teratomas?
Okay, oh, teratomas.
Teratomas are so weird.
Oh, I love them, but they're weird. I mean, I don't love them.
But you do not.
I do not have a teratoma. I don't know if anyone here. Teratomas basically are masses. They're benign, typically, and they sometimes contain teeth, eye, hair, brain, and they're usually in the ovaries. And what happens is about 50% of them, no less, they're finding, because everyone who had this disease had teratomas. That was the defining feature of it. But now they're finding you don't need to have a teratoma to have this disease. But so the first many women who were studied, the first 10 women had teratomas in their ovaries. But the theory behind that they know the cause then, because they think, okay, you have this teratoma. It has brain matter in it. The antibodies attack that brain matter and then start attacking your own brain. That's kind of the belief in those. I didn't specifically have one, but do not Google the word teratoma. I mean, or do.
No,
but
what you do is you Google images.
Yeah, do not do that. Or at least, if you don't do it.
No, do it. Because when I read,
I did. Did you?
When I read your book, I did.
Okay. In this, I have an amazing graphic designer who he's an illustrator who illustrated like right here, like my ring. You can see there, he illustrated a lot. And actually a lot of it didn't get in, but he did an illustration of a teratoma. I'm like, I think we shouldn't go there with an illustration of teratoma, so, yeah. Yes,
thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
All right.
Thank you. Oh my God, that's great! Thank you so much. This is a great place. Oh, by the way, I got flight behavior. Did you like that? Did you?
I didn't
that?
Read that one.
Who recommended that? Who recommended that?
It might be the lady Lisa in our.